This webinar series presents key findings from the School Nutrition and Meal Cost Study. This webinar focuses on findings related to the dietary intakes of students who did and did not participate in the National School Lunch Program. The first webinar in the series provides an overview of the study, and four other webinars present key findings related to school meal program operations, compliance with the updated nutrition standards and the nutritional quality of school meals, school meal costs and revenues, and satisfaction with school meals and plate waste. Starting in school year 2012-13, the school meal programs began to undergo widespread changes, including updated nutrition standards for meals, additional lunch reimbursement for meals that met the standards, and rules affecting the price charged for full-price lunches. The School Nutrition and Meal Cost Study collected data in school year 2014-15 and was the first comprehensive national assessment of the programs since these major reforms began. To assess the dietary intakes of school lunch participants and non-participants, sampled students completed a 24-hour dietary recall. These interviews collected detailed information on all foods and beverages consumed during a 24-hour period on a school day. Foods that students obtained from school meals were matched to each school's lunch menu to ensure that their nutrient content was accurately reflected. Students were categorized as school lunch participants or non-participants based on whether their school's administrative records indicated that they had participated in the school lunch program on the day covered in their 24-hour dietary recall. The final analysis sample included more than 2,100 students. In comparing the dietary intakes of school lunch participants and non-participants, the analysis controlled for observable characteristics that may influence participation, for example, age, gender, and household income. We compared the lunch intakes of school lunch participants and a comparison group of non-participants and found several important differences in the types of foods the two groups of students consumed at lunch on a given day. School lunch participants were more likely than non-participants to consume milk, fruits and 100% juices, and vegetables at lunch. For example, 66% of school lunch participants consumed milk at lunch, compared to 23% of non-participants. Similarly, 43% of participants consumed vegetables at lunch, compared to 21% of non-participants. As shown on the right-hand side of the figure, participants were less likely than non-participants to consume desserts, snacks, and beverages other than milk and 100% juice at lunch. Fewer than half of participants consumed these foods at lunch, but 3/4 of non-participants did. School lunch participants consumed lunches that provided significantly fewer calories than the lunches consumed by non-participants. This slide compares students' intakes of total fat, saturated fat, and protein at lunch as a percentage of the calories consumed at lunch. The lunches consumed by school lunch participants provided a smaller percentage of calories from total fat and saturated fat than the lunches consumed by non-participants. For example, the lunches consumed by participants contained 28% of calories from total fat, compared to 31% of calories from total fat in the lunches consumed by non-participants. As shown on the right-hand side of the figure, participants' lunches provided a larger percentage of calories from protein relative to non-participants' lunches. Next, we'll look at the nutritional quality of students' diets, both at lunch and over 24 hours. We use the 2010 version of the Healthy Eating Index, or the HEI 2010, to examine the nutritional quality of students' diets. The HEI 2010 assigns scores to students' diets based on consistency with recommendations of the Dietary Guidelines for Americans. This includes scores for 9 adequacy components, which include food groups such as fruits, vegetables, dairy, and whole grains, 3 moderation components, which focus on sodium, empty calories, and refined grains, which are dietary components that most people need to decrease, and a total score that provides a measure of overall nutritional quality. Scores are expressed as a percentage of a maximum possible score, and scores closer to 100% indicate intakes of higher nutritional quality. The nutritional quality of the lunches consumed by participants was significantly higher than the quality of the lunches consumed by non-participants. Lunches consumed by participants received a total HEI 2010 score of 80% of the maximum, compared to a score of 65% for non-participants. This figure shows HEI scores for the 9 adequacy components for the lunches consumed by participants and non-participants. As a reminder, scores closer to 100% indicate lunches of higher nutritional quality. The lunches consumed by participants had significantly higher scores for whole grains, dairy, and total vegetables than the lunches consumed by non-participants. For whole grains and dairy, participants' lunches received the maximum possible score, which indicates that the concentrations of these components in their lunches were very consistent with the dietary guidelines recommendations. The higher scores for total vegetables and dairy are consistent with the prior findings that participants were more likely than non-participants to consume vegetables and milk in their lunches. The lunches consumed by participants did receive a significantly lower score for seafood and plant proteins than the lunches consumed by non-participants. This could be driven in part by the lower proportion of participants who consumed peanut butter sandwiches at lunch relative to non-participants. There were also significant differences between participants and non-participants in scores for 2 of the moderation components. For these components, higher scores mean lower concentrations of refined grains, empty calories, and sodium in students' lunches. The lunches consumed by participants received significantly higher scores for refined grains and empty calories than the lunches consumed by non-participants. This indicates that the concentrations of these components were lower in participants' lunches. Scores for sodium were similar for both groups of students. Because lunch represents just a portion of students' diets, it's important to examine the nutritional quality of their diets over 24 hours as well. As shown on the left-hand side of this figure and discussed previously, the lunches consumed by participants were more nutritious than the lunches consumed by non-participants. Over 24 hours, which includes all food students consumed over the course of the day, including their lunch, this trend continued, but the difference in the total HEI score between participants and non-participants was smaller than the difference observed at lunch. For individual HEI components, some of the differences in scores for lunch intakes between school lunch participants and non-participants persisted over 24 hours, but other differences did not. Over 24 hours, participants' diets continued to have higher scores for whole grains, refined grains, and dairy. However, the size of the differences between participants and non-participants was smaller than it was for their lunch intakes. The differences observed at lunch in scores for total vegetables, seafood and plant proteins, and empty calories did not continue over 24 hours. This means, for example, that participants and non-participants had similar intakes of vegetables and empty calories over the course of a school day, despite having healthier intakes of these components at lunch. The study also looked at the relationship between student participation in the school lunch program and the nutritional quality of the lunches in students' schools. We used the HEI 2010 to measure the nutritional quality of lunches provided to students, where higher scores indicate more nutritious lunches. In school year 2014-15, the share of students who participated in the school lunch program was significantly higher in schools with the most nutritious lunches than in schools with the least nutritious lunches. This is important because there were concerns that students wouldn't want to eat more nutritious lunches. More information on these findings, as well as findings for the other study objectives, can be accessed on FNS's website using the link shown here. This includes the study reports, infographics, and additional webinars, including one that provides additional details on the methods used to assess students' dietary intakes described in this webinar.